The chief operating officer of my flagship company, Aerolite Meteorites, sent me a meme to get me psyched for TEDx today. And this is what it says. You are a ghost driving a meat-coated skeleton made from stardust, riding a rock, floating through space. Fear nothing. Sounds good, right? If I fear one thing, it's death by asteroid impact. But we'll get to that. We humans think we're pretty clever, don't we? With our engineering and our tech and our smartphones and our search for extraterrestrial intelligence, we've spent a lot of time and effort looking for aliens out there in space. As far as I know, we haven't found any yet, although J. Edgar Hoover and some of the Air Force intelligence officers at Area 51 may argue with me about that. If alien intelligence was watching us now, studying our social structure, I believe they would consider me to be a garbage man. A celestial garbage man, but a garbage man nonetheless. And that is because my work involves traveling around the surface of this big asteroid we like to call the Earth, collecting celestial garbage. And another word for celestial garbage is meteorite. Here's an amusing thought, anecdote about meteorites. If our predecessors, the reptilian dinosaurs, had a space program of their own and a sensible asteroid defense initiative, which we as humans need, they would probably still be the dominant life form today on Earth, and we wouldn't even be here. Why? Well, about 66 million years ago, a gigantic asteroid, or as I prefer to call it, a large meteorite, slammed into the Yucatan Peninsula in what is today southern Mexico with such enormous force and devastation that it sent a heat wave and a shock wave that annihilated all life almost instantaneously for hundreds of miles in every direction. And it threw millions of tons of dust and ash and little teeny droplets of molten material up into the sky. And some of that material hung there for many years, causing an effect similar to what we imagine a nuclear winter might be. Temperatures lowered, plants died, and the dinosaurs became extinct. What happened next was smaller, adaptable, warm-blooded mammals evolved into the dominant life form, and that's us. So without meteorites wiping out the dinosaurs, we may never have risen to prominence on Earth. But it gets more profound than that. In 1998, a meteorite fell in Morocco. We call it ZAG. It was found to contain water and salt crystals. And another meteorite, a very rare type, a carbonaceous chondrite named a Yende, fell in Chihuahua, Mexico in 1969, and it was found to contain organic compounds, including amino acids. So it is possible, or even likely, that meteorites brought the materials necessary for life to Earth. And so we, all of us humans, and all the mammals, perhaps owe our dominant status on this planet to meteorites. They may have seeded life here, they seem to have wiped out the dinosaurs and allowed us to evolve into the dominant life form. So in order to really understand this, I want you to understand a little bit more about meteorites, and I want you to take three terms away with you. Meteoroid, meteor, meteorite. Now, meteoroid's sort of the tricky one. That's a potential meteorite. It's a chunk of celestial debris, usually from an asteroid, traveling through space, particularly encountering the atmosphere that surrounds our planet. When it enters the atmosphere and it starts to burn and incandesce the air around it, it becomes a shooting star. And the technical word for a shooting star is a meteor. And if any of that material survives and lands on the surface of our planet, it becomes a meteorite. Now, meteorites are divided into three main groups. The stones are the most abundant. They usually don't look that impressive from the outside, but they've traveled a long way to be here. They're quite similar to Earth rocks in composition, and they include minerals that are familiar to geologists like feldspar and plagioclase. Iron meteorites are perhaps the most striking, and they're what people think meteorites should really look like. They were once part of the molten core of a large asteroid, and when they flew through our atmosphere, melting, they often acquired fantastical animal-like shapes. And the third group, the rarest and the most puzzling, are the Stoney Irons, a mixture of stone and iron. The mesosiderites were thought to have been formed when asteroids collided with each other in the asteroid belt millions of years ago. And the beautiful and mysterious palisites, 50% nickel iron, 50% silicate, and in their case, the silicate is olivine, the August birthstone, also known as peridot. So when we find and study a rare palisite, we're literally looking at gems from outer space. Now, to help us in our work, we are fortunate because meteorites exhibit many unusual surface features that we simply don't see on pedestrian Earth rocks. Paramount among them, perhaps, is fusion crust, a thin black rind that forms on the surface of these rocks as they're hurtling through our atmosphere, burning, and the surface actually gets toasted by temperatures in the thousands of degrees Fahrenheit. And this fusion crust is fragile and will weather away over time. So a stone with fresh fusion crust is known to us to be a recent fall. And when those meteorites are flying through our atmosphere and the surface gets superheated and it starts to melt, some of it actually flows and produces these delicate, beautiful features called flow lines. But perhaps the most alluring and mysterious feature is the Vidbenstätten pattern. This is a beautiful, geometric, lattice-like structure that's unique to iron meteorites. It's not found in any Earth rocks, and is a result of extremely slow cooling over millions of years in deep space. And to me, the most intriguing part is that, like snowflakes, every iron meteorite has a different Vidbenstätten pattern. Now, the meteorites come to us primarily from the asteroid belt between Mars and Jupiter, the main belt asteroids, and a few from the Moon and Mars. But the asteroids are the primary parent bodies of the meteorites that we find on Earth. And some of these asteroids have remained almost unchanged since the early days of the solar system. They were not altered by heat or water, as some of their neighbors were. And we call these undifferentiated asteroids. They're made up primarily of chondrules, which are tiny, glassy, colorful spheres that were formed at the very, very beginning of the solar system, in the solar nebula. And through a strange process called accretion, they started to clump together in little groups, and those clumps got larger and formed rubble piles, and they eventually grew into the asteroids and the planets, the rocky bodies that orbit our sun. So, when we find a chondrule-rich meteorite, we are looking at material that is 4.6 to 4.7 billion years old, or as old as our solar system itself, predating the origin of our own planet. Do you think that's the oldest thing any human has ever touched at almost 4.7 billion years? No, it's not. Wrap your mind around this. Some of these chondrites, carbonaceous chondrites in particular, contain microdiamonds, tiny diamonds that are the remnants of an ancient supernova that predates our own solar system. They're 12 billion years old. So when we find and examine and hold one of these alien visitors from outer space, we are holding something that is so ancient and from an existence so different from the one that we know, it's difficult to even comprehend. So, we humans, we're questioning adventurous creatures, aren't we? We want to get out to space. We want to develop better technology. We want to live longer. But we're fragile, too. We're delicate. All of us, everyone in this room, you and me, we all depend on an invisible gas to live. And were it not for this invisible gas, oxygen, most of us wouldn't survive more than a minute, about as long as we could hold our breath. So the oxygen that surrounds us allows us to take a breath. Everything's going to be fine. But the atmosphere is our friend for another reason. It protects us from being constantly bombarded by falling meteorites. Most potential meteorites burn up in the atmosphere. And if you wonder what the surface of our planet might look like without a protective atmosphere, just take a look at our closest celestial neighbor, ladies and gentlemen, the moon, peppered with millions of meteorite craters. Imagine trying to walk the dog or wash the car if that was going on. You wouldn't last long out in the open. So, what happens when meteorites do survive their passage through the atmosphere and land on Earth? You may be surprised to know that contrary to what you've seen in Hollywood movies, they're usually not huge, molten, glowing fireballs crashing into Grand Central Station, but rather rocks that come to land on the surface of our planet somewhat gently at an average speed of, 200 or 300 miles an hour, which is just a little bit faster than a golf ball, and much like that. And those are real meteorites. Why does this happen? Well, 90% of our atmosphere is in the 9 miles closest to the surface of our planet. So, as meteoroids, potential meteorites, streak through the atmosphere, they decelerate. And some come to land gently on the surface, like that, and larger ones make impact pits, which is really just a fancy scientific name for a dent in the ground. Larger meteorites that are more dense and traveling at higher velocity will make craters. And not surprisingly, the larger the meteorite, the larger the crater that it makes. And in the course of my work, I've had the great good fortune to visit many of the most amazing meteorite craters in the world, in all over Europe, in Canada, in South America, in Australia, in Russia. And one of the most spectacular is in my adopted home state of Arizona, known as Meteor Crater. It's where NASA trained some of the Apollo astronauts because it was such a spectacular feature. Now, perhaps my favorite crater is Ries in southern Germany. And this giant hole in the ground, ladies and gentlemen, is a spectacular 14 million years old, and it's 24 kilometers across. Inside this crater, there happens to be a charming little walled city with a red roof. And the amazing thing is, the town is round, and it's roughly the size of the impactor that made the crater, and it's sitting in the middle of the crater. Isn't that something? And you get that they built the town after the impact, right? Okay, just checking. So, the force of this tremendous impact that formed a crater 14 kilometers in diameter was such that target rock was melted and formed a beautiful green glass that we call moldavite. And in the middle of this town is a church made of impact breccia, a rock formed when earth rock is melted by the meteorite impact. So I climbed to the top of this church, and at the top of this church, you can see the entire rim of the crater, and it's spectacular. And I texted a friend of mine, and I said, "Oh my gosh, I'm at the top of a church made out of impact breccia in the middle of a town that's the size of the meteorite that made the crater that this town sits in. I'm having a space rock epiphany." And a moment later, a message comes back that says, "Nerd." And here's the best part of the story. The name of the town is Nerdlingen. For real. So we humans have a long history of working with meteorites. We've fashioned them into tools and weapons and even jewelry. So they've influenced our development both as a race and also through technology. And spacecraft designers studied the shapes of oriented meteorites because nature knows how best to ablate heat. And so meteorites have actually helped in the design of spacecraft. So, what is next for the checkered past of humans and meteorites? I propose to you, ladies and gentlemen, the exploration of space. We have learned that meteorites come from the asteroids. And so by studying meteorites, we come to learn what the asteroids are composed of. And what have we discovered? The asteroids are rich in materials that we want. Iron, nickel, water, gold. We can extract oxygen and valuable gases like helium from these asteroids. And so private sector space companies like Deep Space Industries are figuring out how to do this. In our lifetime, we're going to see robot ships going to the asteroids and mining the raw materials that we need to build anything that we can use to explore and colonize space. It is a fantastically exciting time to be a super evolved mammal on a giant asteroid traveling through space. In my work, recovering meteorites, I have found the experience of uncovering a buried space rock to be one of the most amazing and invigorating things I could possibly hope to accomplish. I'm the first person to put sunlight on this alien visitor and remove it from its tomb where it's lain for thousands of years. And when I do that, for a moment, I almost feel like I can see the structure of the universe, all those amazing cogs and wheels moving together beautifully with a little teeny sign that says, "You are here." So, ladies and gentlemen, next time you look up into the night sky and you see a shooting star fly overhead, I ask you to reflect upon this. Not only is it telling us where we came from, it is a beacon telling us what is next for humanity. Thank you.